Wow. I don't know who he was introducing, but the guy sounds fancy. I have to apologize first. I know I'm a little overdressed for the West Coast. But I do want to point out that I'd prefer it, you know, if it doesn't get back to the office, because I'm not wearing a tie, so I could be serious. But as he did mention, I have known Richard for a very long time, and I'm very excited to talk about a mix of subjects. I'm not representing any formal official positions of the U.S. government or the government of Japan or other entities. These are my views. But I think we can talk through what I think are three themes that we see in innovation in technology policy and innovation. And that's really this relationship between the kinds of physical features that we see, the technologies and, you know, the advances in the state of art of science and other disciplines, and how that works together with the user or the systems, and how important consumer behavior is to realizing a successful system. And, you know, maybe we can just think through as we're talking together over the next hour about maybe things that, you know, you always thought were going to be the greatest, most coolest thing ever, and then, like, something really dumb got elected. I mean, got more popular. But the other piece here that Richard mentioned that's really important is you can have the best technologies. You can have everybody raring to go and excited about a solution. And sometimes for other reasons that are beyond the control of the entrepreneur or the individual consumer, those solutions aren't widely available for other reasons. And sometimes that's a mix of competition policy issues. Sometimes there are concerns around how the users interact with maybe third parties in the system. But the area of sort of law and policy is something that is sometimes not as closely or as carefully sort of integrated in that sort of a strategy. So I think what we're going to try to do is talk through, at least in the context of sort of the energy case and how we're talking about particularly the consumption and the production of electricity, what are sort of features there that we see in maybe at least three domains? The production of electricity and the problems that sort of roll around, you know, the physics of it and the engineering of designing and realizing solutions. And then the distribution and separately the consumption of it, because those are all different features that I think we can observe in those models. The other thing, which I think many of us share an interest in at the US Asia Technology Center, is how the United States, in particular, shares a very important and, in some cases, almost a symbiotic relationship with jurisdictions in Asia. And maybe a couple months ago, Richard and I were in Japan at a conference looking at the digital economy with people. And among some just amazing colleagues from all over the world. And later on, I think I had gone back through an email chain and was thinking about some stuff, and something pops up on my Facebook page, which I'm going to call the Facebook Times from now because it's mostly my news source, I'm afraid. But the quote was from Tim Cook, who you may know. He's not actually big. I think it's a fad, but it's this thing called Macintosh is it airplanes or computers? Anyway, it's like some technical thing. I don't know what it is, but it's kind of an iPhone. Mr. Cook is speaking with the Prime Minister of Japan about the iPhone and its impact globally. And the quote that pops up is, "Were it not for the history of innovation in Japan, the iPhone would not exist." And so what I'd like us to do also is we're sort of thinking through the mechanics of how does innovation and innovative sort of production of electricity and consumption of electricity work, and together with that idea about how the law and policy pieces fit together, what are energy solutions at their core? And there's a lot of answers probably to that question, but the one we're going to focus on today relates more to the IoT angle. There are elements in a system that are going to leverage the collection of information and the exchange of information, and then the coordination of behavior across many elements in the system, and that's going to be an important function of how those systems probably realize some sort of an innovation vector, if you want to think of it that way. And so thinking about other IoT sorts of problems, I think we might take some time and think about maybe some topics in transportation, maybe some manufacturing, maybe communications, and pause for a moment about the sorts of things that you see in both the technology space as well as sort of the consumer behavior space in Japan. And I think Asia in general represents this general case, but the role of the technical elements in a solution together with how consumers actually interact with systems, we can see behaviors that weren't realized in the United States for 20 years or more later, way, 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 way back early on. So with that theme in mind, I think we'll look at also Japan as maybe a place to look to for things that might be coming, because on several topics, on those features of technology and consumer sort of behavior, as well as around law and policy concerns, there might be some things that we can talk through that might give us a little bit of interesting things to think about as we're going through this discussion of sustainable energy and how things will change maybe going forward. So I'd like to start, we're talking about energy. There's a lot of really interesting writing. How many folks have had physics 1, physics 2? Most folks, I would imagine. But we know the story, the sort of storyline that we hear. There were a number of fundamental physics discoveries made late in the 1800s around electricity. And there was this explosion of interest, lots of things happening, and then all of this coordination of innovations that tried to bring electricity to rural customers and all over. And I think the storyline largely starts around Edison and backing that he got from J.P. Morgan and others to try to test his ideas with the electric lighting, which largely displaced things like gas lighting that had a sort of a bad habit of suddenly blowing up and exploding, and I guess it was messy to clean up or something else. But people tended to prefer the electric light innovations that were coming around. And the story goes on, and initially what you learn when you start reading a little more deeply is that most of the sorts of things that they were doing early on were sort of point of sale-ish. They had the sort of early prototypes of power generation largely at the sites. They were noisy. They tended to be dangerous. There were a lot of complexities around the equipment. They were heavy and bulky. And the other problem was there weren't a lot of corollaries in sort of the business space either. People were used to dealing with commodities. And if we think of a commodity as something that, you sort of make it, it shares the same features, you can reduce it to some sort of a price or other component, and it's fungible across different people, you can pass it around. Electricity, they had a real hard time early on thinking about how to conceptualize it, because you used it, but then what you were actually consuming was light. And you could think about oil and slushing along the oil carts and such, but if you had some sort of production of electricity, you couldn't store it. It wasn't something that you could put in a bucket and carry to your neighbor's house. So the early technology did influence that course of discovery and sort of adoption. And so the storyline goes that, as they were thinking through how to make this a business, they recognized that the technology really wasn't there for the kind of business models they were looking at. It would be really difficult to try to build out all of that power production and all of the mechanisms that would make it work. There were problems of understanding how to fit a certain amount of electricity and predict it and distribute it and try to address the problems of a marketplace of electricity. And so not so much Edison, but people that were working with Edison who were doing development, there are a bunch of companies that are forming around this time, they started to focus on essentially how to on a larger scale produce electricity. They were dealing with mechanics and engineering problems, which we all sort of intuitively have some sort of like, oh, I know a problem like that sort of solution. They had big flywheels at the time that would spin, and they would translate kinetic energy from engines into essentially a rotation that they could use in a magnet. But those flywheels were really difficult to manufacture, and they'd reached sort of engineering constraints on how they could improve the capacity for these engines. And then all of a sudden somebody said, you know what? You don't have to translate that rotational force into something else. You could just like have a gas and have it spin through a turbine. Huge and you know, amazing sort of engineering discovery. But that also was quite amenable to the economies of scale of a larger production, and so may have played a part in that discovery. But clearly, the technology was at least a piece of why it took a particular path. And I think we'll talk a little bit in a second about another corollary to that that makes good sense too. So the story that we're used to hearing is there's centralized production, there's distribution of electricity, and there's consumption at points that are many distributed across some sort of large geographic area. It's commodified in a certain way. There's markets that are essentially centralized again and manage sort of the consumption side and the production side. And we're looking maybe now at evolutions in that thought. We're trying to, I think we're beginning to see people understanding that, you know, I'd like to have, you know, electricity where it's not available, like in the mountains or like in my garage that I built in the back, and I don't want to have to run a wire, and I might have situations where it moves. So maybe things around how consumer behavior are intersecting with changes in technology are suggesting maybe there's a change in that fundamental sort of storyline about production needing to be centralized and distribution being a central piece of it that's also larger scale, and then consumption essentially being something that's with a faraway actor, but single and few in number. In this graph, though, we see sort of like the storyline that I think is emerging in a lot of renewable sectors, where you've got essentially production, and you push that electricity into an inverter, and most of that electricity, in most cases, is just going back to the grid. So again, imagine, you know, Edison with his problem. There's no bucket to put the electricity in. That was a sort of a common problem around how you would store locally, and it's a lot easier just to dump AC back into the grid. So a lot of systems were, I think up until, you know, fairly recently, didn't include a battery component. You'll notice that this is optional in the grid, and now this represents a change in how people talk about these models. For maybe somebody that comes from a different sector, it might seem quite intuitive. And then if we're looking at problems, what sort of things on the consumer side do we see are maybe the same problems they saw back then? If I'm producing electricity at a local site, I'll produce it, but it may not correspond directly with when I need to consume it. And so one of the problems that they had once they started to industrialize electric power production was, you know, you might have surpluses when people don't need it, and you can't store it, and you got to use it. It's sort of a something at a produce line that has a limited shelf life, and so if you don't have a market for that, you're going to realize losses, and those losses affect sort of the efficiency of the system, both economically and from an engineering perspective. So things like elevators and sort of off-peak uses were part of early marketplace, and we see those going on. In the model that we're seeing now, where people are saying you could have a solar panel, for example, on your house, wouldn't have to be that. You could have all sorts of stuff. But that production won't always correspond with your individual use. So if you're pushing it back into the grid, that's one idea. But the other piece around the production is consumption may fit certain patterns. Maybe those sorts of patterns are lumpy or have some geographic component. Imagine
Can I interrupt you for just a second? This graph that you're showing right now is really very much the system that TEPCO was talking about a couple of weeks ago from Tokyo, with small-scale wind production being added in along with solar production. Notice that the point of measurement is really the substation battery pack. Right. Whereas the previous one that you showed, the point of measurement was the household meter.
Exactly.
And that's a new kind of thing where you're talking about neighborhood power as opposed to an individual selling power back into the grid.
And you can't have Richard Dasher in the room because he always will steal the intellectual awesome thunder.
That
is precisely, that's the most important takeaway from this slide. And that is, if we're moving away from a model where production isn't centralized and monolithic and you've got multiple people, what are the same sort of problems they experienced even back then? You still have to have some marketplace. There has to be some way of taking the power and getting it to people who need it when they need it at the level of use that they require. And so one approach has always been you meter the traffic, the electricity going back into the grid, and then basically, you know, you balance the checkbook at the end of the month, and if you gave more, maybe you get some your money back, and if you don't, then you won't. But if we were to change this just slightly and introduce something in this mix, you might see the sorts of things that Richard is suggesting. But what are the sorts of things that are still missing from this chart? And so, if we were going to do this kind of a problem and we were going to address the kinds of variability that does occur and be able to accommodate different sorts of models, what might that solution look like? For example, one of the problems that we note with sort of personalizing or localizing these problems, and again, these are in a lot of ways very similar problems to the sorts of, you know, problems people talk about with search or all these other things. You want to tailor the use to a particular individual, but you also can only do that based on basically some sort of aggregate view of people's behavior. Well, in some cases, you're drilling down, but you're never going to have perfect knowledge of an individual's behavior or preferences. There's always going to be this predictable sort of component to it. And so whether you're trying to meet the plant production and sort of aggregate demands on the production side, or distributing the power in ways that meet the requirements of the individuals that are involved, you're still going to have some need for something more complex, perhaps, and more reliant on some sort of information exchange. And so to just tease out a little bit more from Richard's point, if you live in a residential neighborhood, or let's say it's a multi-unit dwelling, right? You might expect people would have solar panels attached. There was an interesting question on Japan's Solar City fact page I saw today that was kind of interesting. If I don't own the panels, but I'm still sort of in control of them, do I realize the metered value of that? Yes, apparently according to the web page. But you might be pulling in power more or less at the same rate and time as everyone else in the building. You might have the same size battery as everyone else. Who else is in the neighborhood that might need that power? Typically, industrial and commercial use has sort of offset demand and consumption from consumer markets. When consumers are gone, industries might be using power, and then when they're offline, then other folks will jump in. So,
averaging is a lousy way to do so.
Because the lows have to still meet the minimum needs. You can never go below the minimum needs of all the people on the network. So if you're averaging, basically what you end up doing is having a lot of waste in the highs.
Exactly. And so what I think what you want to do is maybe think to other kinds of problems that have similar features. So we're going to talk a little bit about other markets. Spectrum is one that we sort of were chatting about early on that share that same feature. Trying to rely on, for example, averages, where you're really looking at a distribution that isn't normal, maybe it's way peaky on one end of the distribution, the tails are long, not a good predictor in some cases. Certainly we can talk about the statistics, but looks more like, you know, some sort of a CDF might be helpful, maybe something that's more sensitive to other features of the data that you're pulling in. But you probably aren't going to rely solely on a mean to do that. And maybe that involves more information exchange. Perhaps in some ways it's even more specific in terms of time or other sorts of domains. But regardless, personalizing it and localizing it seems like a really, really great sort of extension of where we started with electric power, but also the sort of place where things maybe, at the time, the technology wasn't there, maybe the business models didn't seem to support it, just really weren't the direction that electric power took. So if we're looking for things that, you know, from our model, what are missing and what are things that might be encumbering that sort of development, you know, a lot of people focus on what incentives are in place for consumers to participate in a market. Certainly it's an issue for any business. And if you look at some of the metrics that emerge around photovoltaics, for example, there are, for example, essentially return on investment per megawatt or per watt sorts of indicators. And so, you know, just like we saw with other sorts of industrial transformations early, people are interested in what the costs and efficiencies are. But not just what the numbers are, but who realizes those different pieces. If you're the guy on the cost side and you're realizing all the costs and you're not taking advantage of efficiencies, the incentive might not be for you to maybe jump in for that piece of the technical component. If you're realizing a lot of returns and you're getting the upside from some sort of an exchange that takes advantage of efficiencies or other sorts of new features in the marketplace, you might be really excited about that. So understanding what the implications are for the economics around whether or not it's deployed in one way or another, how risks are sort of allocated among users, and who sort of realizes and how the upsides, it probably makes a difference. And I think the features that we're going to talk about maybe in a little bit now will be around other marketplaces and how you do see broad adoption of some technical solutions, maybe where somebody's at least sussed that out and the incentives seem to align in a way that consumers are excited about. Also, the feature that Richard was talking about. If you're going to have a new system that relies heavily on the exchange of information and that being sort of the basis for realizing benefits in the system, you better well understand what the demands are and the costs are so that you can actually accomplish the goal. If you're, for example, as Richard had suggested, relying on the wrong kind of data, or the data, either because it's imprecise or it's inaccurate, doesn't solve your problems, you might be in a world of hurt. And so as we were talking earlier, all y'all need to look at that pretty closely. But ensuring also that the solutions are easy to use and facilitate adoption is another piece. And I think what we see right now, and I don't think there's a need to sort of like delve into a lot of product description, but you can actually, I think we're real close to see them regularly on the television. You don't see them so much on the East Coast, but I certainly saw a couple out here. You are seeing consumer devices, which are in effect plug and play, stick it on your wall, throw something on your roof, plug it into your car. That kind of discussion, I think, is really exciting because what it demonstrates is it might be at the point where the technology piece is coming into play, the consumer usability, the interaction with both the user to machine interfaces as well as the machine to machine stuff might be at a point where maybe we're seeing an inflection where it starts to get really interesting. So when we're going to look at that problem, I think we want to pause for a minute because we've talked a little bit about spectrum. And I think for those of us that have had physics, we may remember that there's a fundamental physics relationship between electricity as we understand it, you know, for induction or storage or as it passes through a wire, and the kinds of things we talk about as radio. So if we were going to look at a typical scenario for I've lost my other slide here. Okay, if we're going to look at a charging solution, for example, you look at our upper right here where we've got some rotation and there's a magnetic field, you can see the coil. What is this going to show if I'm rotating this at some velocity? Who can help me out here? Does anybody recognize this and know what the equation might look like? So we spin this, we create an electromagnetic flux that then goes through here and we can see voltage or we can look for power or whatever else, right? So, I mean, that stuff happened right about the same time somebody else was looking at this kind of an apparatus. They started looking at things and saying, oh, I see another way, a really neat sort of effect here. If I induce some sort of a electric field and I can spark, you know, this connection, I can observe an effect over here. And I can observe the magnitude of the electricity that responds on this side. So at the same time, people were looking at how to create electricity from magnetic fields. They were also looking at how you could use that or other techniques to generate a field and then capture it somewhere that was wireless. The ether could carry that electricity to somewhere else. And we forget sometimes that, for example, wireless inductive charging or things like that, they're not that far away from RF energy, which should give us a little pause, because this apparatus, which is, I pulled this up, really interesting story about a guy who owns some industrial activity up in Appleton, Wisconsin, heard about this thing Edison was doing. He's like, I'm excited. I'm going to make an electrical station and do electrical-y stuff. I would imagine that, you know, as he's looking at this, we also had folks looking at, you know, this is a Tesla's apparatus for the utilization of radiant energy, sort of similar sorts of things. But if we were to put Edison or Tesla or anybody that was active around that time next to this plot, and then put him next to, this is just an example of a wiring diagram for somebody's basement that a do-it-yourself person put together. If you start thinking about, well, where did all these electrical symbols come from and when? They're around the time these guys were building stuff in somebody's tool shed. This is the same electrical, essentially the same model that Edison or Tesla might have been playing around with 100 or more years ago. Now, if we pause on that for a minute, I mean, the ground symbol is in Tesla's, this is in his application. That's where the ground symbol comes from. These technical solutions are more than 100 years old. And if any of these guys were actually vampires walking around, they could probably pass the PE exam. No, I'm kidding. All right, so we'll stop there. But the next slide, let's go a little bit farther. We'll look at what was going on the radio side. What was Marconi doing, for example? Marconi, and you can look at some of the patent diagrams that were filed around the time. There's some really interesting, they used to call them shacks, you know, people building their own radio systems. So if you want to flip back through these slides, you got your do-it-yourselfer here wiring up his basement, pulling wire into his 120-volt system. Not that hard. How many homebrew people are doing MIPO antenna apparatus or dual phase antennas or doing anything at the chip layer with modern modulation techniques? How many folks at your local ham radio club are doing LTE receivers? It's funny because, you know, for those of us that are sort of radio nerds, you have trouble even doing stuff that was like cutting edge in the 40s in your garage. Now, let's think about that for a minute. So Edison and Tesla are walking around, you know, maybe with some friends on their way to the PE exam. Is Marconi going to be able to step into any sort of a development role and do radio today? Why? Well, I think if we go back to that first discussion, the synergy between how technology affects how consumers interact with it, the state of the art of the time, the role of consumers, how those solutions come together, and in some ways, maybe the law and policy also, influence a particular trajectory. And what I think, if we think about that storyline that we started with Edison and folks more than 100 years ago, trying to work through the problem of how they would architect solutions to supply the sorts of you know, business solutions that they were troubled with, how much progress have we seen on the electric utility side versus the radio side? Today, if we take a little bit of a diversion, you can do things like commoditize electricity in the form of communications. We could talk about packetized data, We could talk about business models about how people share infrastructure costs. We can talk about how people predict and manage demand. We can talk about a lot of really sophisticated things on the radio side. But if we wanted to go back to that first slide, where even the mechanical elements of an electrical production, distribution, and consumption system are really sort of now, some 100 years later, starting to be things you could maybe see at Walmart. While at the same time, you can go to Walmart and buy an older Samsung phone for $100. That is a big gap. And so I think if we want to think about how did that gap develop and why, and what are the sorts of things from the communication side or other sorts of IoT industries that we could maybe observe some features from that would address those sorts of questions about how we would take the production and the consumption and those sorts of problems from a different space and apply problems and solutions for renewable energy. And I think that what it does is if we just pull back a little bit and think about what that personal and local sort of power problem looks like, it is absolutely a mix of technology, improvements around probably sensors and systems, and all the development that we've seen on the RF side provides all sorts of opportunities for how the elements in an energy production or consumption system could improve. We've also seen how people's attitudes about communications and radio have sort of transformed over the last 100 years. That's significant. People expect things right now and when they need it. They're not satisfied anymore with the sort of notion that, you know, we'll wait till we get home and then I'll call everybody back in Kansas. That's not part of how consumers interact with cell phones, for example, right now. And the law and policy around how we take systems that were once centralized, highly structured, and it's fair to say heavily regulated, and then move those into an environment where consumers can drive the decision making for themselves, where small entities can interact at the level of geography or time space that they're interested in. That's a feature of other sorts of regulated industries that we are starting to get excited about, I think, in the renewable space. And maybe that could be a feature of what's going on. Regardless, though, if we're going to adopt those sorts of models, we might want to think about how the crowd and data are part of that discussion. So now let's talk about maybe a little bit what sort of problems this sort of space, maybe in the energy space, we've been looking at over the last 10 or 15 years. So, you know, Department of Energy, everybody is working, I think, very hard on these topics, and we've seen a lot of interesting work so far. So, I'm a communications guy, so you probably detect a little bit of bias, but of course, you know, there's been great work on smart grids, for example, and smart cities, and in the sort of infrastructure and policy development around urban planning and development. And most people will describe those sorts of solutions as some sort of an integration of information technologies and IoT stuff. So if we want to take a look at maybe some of the things we've seen recently in the last 10 or 15 years, smart meters have been, of course, a big feature in how the utility and the distribution side in particular have tried to improve service to consumers and meet problems with production and distribution. And if we think about sort of what smart meters have been demonstrated to be successful at, they're really good at a couple things. One is they're at the site of the user. So they have access to the information about the electricity flow from the building. That makes it really useful to be more precise with, for example, how billing works. Sort of an aside, but I remember one of the best sort of billing problems I can remember from working in the Bay Area at the late 90s was from the construction aggregate industry. These guys would make these amazing concrete and asphalt plants, and you know, it wasn't as glamorous as working in the fancy, I'm going to make IP protocol stack modifications for sunboxes or something. But you'd go to a plant, they might be realizing $5 million of revenue at a plant. And then we'd talk about, well, what's your billing cycle? Well, you know, 90 days, 100 days, $5 million in your floating capital for those many months. Those sorts of problems are big. And so for a company that has a lot of billing and doesn't have good information flow on that, you can realize a lot of advantages. Now, that reduces costs and maybe makes billing more efficient. Maybe those are benefits that are realized by consumers. But it also helped them to do better time shifting, because the real problem with production side is people's consumption is really lumpy. People all turn their AC on when it gets hot, and then they may not buy electricity at that load for a while. So if you're going to build a plant and it needs to meet the peak load, but the average load is really low, those are going to translate to significant investment decisions. And you know, that makes a difference. So plant production and things like that certainly benefited if we could reduce and shift load, for example. There's been discussions about how that can affect whether or not people need to build more coal-fired power plants or not. That's a benefit. That's certainly something that's been realized. Microgrid solutions and people that are large consumers of electricity, you know, you might think about government sector with large DOD folks that have very precise and maybe architected demands for electricity. They might also have really heightened needs for other features of the delivery of electricity. So, for example, one of the things that's driven a lot of discussion is resiliency and whether or not the electricity is available absolutely when you need it. There are some markets where you know, if you're in the consumer space and the power goes out for a week, that's no fun. And we've certainly experienced that in DC more than a few times recently. And I know there's definitely been a lot of stuff going on and probably will accelerate. How do we deal with, you know, particular users' needs for immediate and consistent power? One solution, make sure you have enough local. What does that tend to look like? Well, it's a supplementing of maybe the time distribution of the electricity. If we wanted to think about distributions in load, maybe they have peak loads that they're just going to supply themselves. Maybe they flip a switch and the generator comes on. I know rural areas of Kansas, certainly people will do that. They can't pull enough off to the 240 pole, so they'll have a local generator when they need to do stuff that's high, you know, high electricity sort of power consumption. If you're doing a lot of welding or things that involve smelting, you know, these are big loads. Maybe there's been you know, a lot of really interesting work there that we can leverage off of. But if we want to think about it at a level that's lower and a lot more distributed, we might be thinking about essentially the crowd being involved. Everybody has consumption concerns, right? Everyone is capable of producing electricity. Everybody that is a homeowner for a single user family will typically have a roof, for example. and so if we want to look back again to the slides, even the ones we were looking at earlier, how much can the legacy system know about the energy that could be created, and by whom, and where, and at what quantity, what sort of magnitude is the vector, and when? Those are features that are difficult to sort of isolate now. Now, we went back to the discussion about sort of local and personal sort of use. The interesting thing about those problems is that they're highly variable in different domains. So we talked a little bit about people turning their air conditioners on, or things that tend to be pretty predictable. You can look at maybe weather modeling and, you know, presume that there's going to be a load that's coming onto a network. But other things, like when do people wash their dishes? You know, when do people turn on the electric stove and cook usually? Maybe there's modeling around that. Maybe people get home at different times and all of their electric cars are going to start to take load at different times. That local variable time and magnitude problem on the production side is the same thing. You might have people on one side of a hill that get sun from 10 to 1 and then from 1 to 3. Other folks might be getting peak sunlight. It would be really neat if you were in a neighborhood to know that sort of thing. What sort of things might you be able to do? Well, for one thing, you might know that Bob down the street's got 50% of capacity charge on his batteries. I'm in the sunlight right now. Maybe I pass some power over there. DC voltage in modern devices. Another thing that's interesting about production side is it just changed because I was hoping to put this slide in, but it's actually different now. until recently, there were no internal wiring standards from ASTM and places like that on DC voltages indoors. Why? Why can't I go to Home Depot and have a connector for a DC LED light and plug it in to some sort of a solar system? It would. I went to Home Depot, actually, because that's the kind of guy I am. I love Home Depot. And I started shopping around for LED lighting because I had thought to put some solar cells on top and maybe power my internal wiring. All of those systems are DC on the voltaic production side, highly variable in time because the amount of electricity that's produced during the day varies, and at some point it might drop to zero. You might have a battery solution that collects that and distributes it, but even if we have, let's say, somewhere in the house power, it would be really neat to be able to plug my laptop in. I've got a 40-watt sort of adapter that I usually plug into a laptop. Why can't I plug into my DC grid? Wouldn't it be neat if there was a plug on the wall that was not 120 volt, but say 43 volts or 12 volts, which is usually the common voltage for a lot of photovoltaics?
For DC. Yeah.
For DC, precisely.
Yeah.
And
so I got to ask you the question, why can't you do it?
So I think some of this, you know, is explained by our storylines. If we go back to the sorts of questions people were struggling with when we started, there was a question about, let's take DC for example. Right. DC, among many engineers still today, is presumed to be a bad solution because of line loss. So in a typical house, if you want to wire this up, you can definitely go to Home Depot today and buy systems, put it on the roof. You've got DC variable sort of voltage and amperage going into some sort of a system. Usually you have a power converter, which will take it and usually convert that electricity into AC. In a lot of cases, that might go out to the grid. It has to be cleaned some way. So there are engineering problems here. But why AC? You're still at DC. You could clean it. You could keep it. You could sump it. When electricity passes through a wire, the physics of it mean some of that electricity gets lost as heat, particularly. Mostly, resistance translated to heat through a wire is your loss. Now, if we look and compare DC versus AC, one of the reasons why AC was adopted so early, and this is part of that whole storyline, was that the line losses were presumed to be less for AC, and they are, than DC. So if you're running copper for 15 or 20 miles, AC works great. It's a lot easier. There's other things. Another feature that people talk about as well, shock concerns. You can, with a high voltage, you're going to deliver more electricity. Well, that's sort of the same problem with voltage, but then you're talking about how the amperages might be set up indoors.
Yeah, but I kind of set you up for that because really I think the technology is there. And what's happened is that the regulation really is dealing with old technology problems that have already been solved.
Yes, and I would agree with that 100%. And part of the question is to understand what sort of arguments people have.
I could never have my entire house running DC.
Okay, so
the local city would never let me do it, right?
Well, if you don't have a building code, and a code has to be in place for wiring, and you're going to get a building inspector to come out to your house, what are the implications there? I mean, a UL stamp on a product goes a long way if you're trying to go down to the county office and get your electrical plat approved for a building construction. So I think you're right, and I think the one piece is how the law and policy piece works, and then the other piece is, have we reached the point where people think about that, or it's a really a market opportunity yet? Absolutely, all of the stuff in my house, short of two motors, were AC. I'm sorry, DC. Every component in my house that was consuming electricity, I did this review about 3 or 4 years ago, I couldn't find anything in my house that wasn't DC. Even the motors in my refrigerator were DC. So historically, there were some pieces, especially electromagnetic things that were usually AC, but again, they were influenced by a particular technology curve. An AC motor can be cheaper and less more reliable in some cases than a DC motor because of how you set them up. And so, you know, I'm not an electrical engineer. I don't work in the power space, so you have to caveat all this with a communications view. But the electromagnetics and the engineering around what we're talking about are the same sorts of problems that have been faced in other industries. And if we want to look to, well, are there incompatibilities with radio design? Are there modulation or other sorts of things people have worked through? Absolutely. And usually you have some sort of a translation layer. People optimize not only for engineering concerns, but for business and other consumer-driven reasons. So here, if we want to think about why, maybe one of the big reasons so far has been most of the influence and thinking in this space has been focused on large-scale centralized production and distribution, and the system works really, really well for that. Doesn't seem to be influenced as heavily by consumer demand or consumer preferences, and maybe is out of step with some of the technology advances. So yes, could you realize a DC home? Absolutely. And there's currently new standards every day coming out for that. And where would that take us? One thing that we want to think about is, in the same way we don't really have good information channels for production, we don't always have good information channels for consumption either. And if you go to your house, and I'd encourage everybody to do this, you'll look at the sorts of things that you have in your house, and all of those devices plug into an adapter. In almost every case, there is no information exchange, even to the most intelligent unit in your system, which is your smart meter. In some cases, there are differences. Some of the larger, for example, HVAC systems, you'll find systems that do have an information channel between them. But how many devices today have their own independent information channel? I mean, you literally have them on the toaster. Why wouldn't you be able to take advantage of those feedback loops? And in fact, when you'll talk to engineers in the sector, they do tend to use existing infrastructure like Wi-Fi in a home for information and do take advantage of it. So if we're thinking about what are the other things, if this is really just an IoT sort of crowdsourcing and data concern, what are some things that we could guide in the few minutes that we'll finish up with?
Well, so the IoT here is really energy devices.
Correct.
Right? So the energy devices, when they have communications functions in them, so that they can communicate using internet protocols, then you really, of course, have this capability that's a new technology development, right? Just
yes.
To kind of summarize up to that.
That's right. And so because the elements in the system might be able to produce information, and that information might help us share information across different users, develop mesh networks around power consumption or production in neighborhoods and other sorts of entities, you'd be able to take advantage of those sorts of features in the system to do that. Now, if you did that, what sort of things, what would be the elements there? First, the communications piece is going to be important. And this tends to be a topic in almost any IoT dialogue you'll see. There are a lot of discussions about if you've got places that are isolated and don't have infrastructure. And there's plenty of considerations there that you might not be able to rely on some existing communications channel. What are the options? Well, this is sort of the spectrum debate. It would be great if you had your own dedicated band that you could put your transceiver on and you had your own license. You can do that in some cases. But then there are other solutions that people do look for. And of course, you know, the things that people tend to reach to, especially in the Bay Area, well, I'll just put some sort of a Wi-Fi transmitter on it and hope for the best. You can do that. Certainly people do it. Usually you're thinking about how that piece interacts with other devices. I'm not so familiar with how much progress there is, but that is definitely a topic. And 5G is sort of the area you see a lot of people focusing discussion now. So that comms and sensor piece, other pieces around how you deploy these things. Who bears the cost of buying it and then setting it up? If we look to the communications sector, people buy, in many cases, their Wi-Fi infrastructure. They may have a device that they rent from their carrier. There's a real mix of models there. And I think what you might want to think about is, would the approaches that are adopted be flexible enough to accommodate lots of different business scenarios? That certainly is something that we could observe from other IoT industries.
What was O&M?
Pardon me?
What is O&M?
Operation and maintenance.
Thank you.
And so that tends to be a very large component of IT purchasing. Usually you'll buy a system, you'll set it up, but the long-term costs of information technology are not to be underestimated. And so a lot of systems, you might buy something, throw it out there, and that really great database solution that you had 15 years ago, today may not serve your needs, and the costs associated with maintaining it, rather than replacing it in some cases, you might see a toss-up there. So there are definitely things that we can see in other IoT sectors that might influence this trajectory.
So this big data concerns, the five Vs, that's really a problem for the information processing that happens in the system?
Exactly. And so if you want to look to other sorts of environments, and sort of familiar with big data, you might have issues around, can the system produce data at a huge volume? Can it consume it at a huge volume? Are the varieties of information that you're looking at sufficient for the needs you might have downstream? Is the speed and rate at which you're doing those, and then is the trust associated with the information sufficient? And you know, all of you guys, I'm sure we can all sort of identify lots of features with privacy and security here that are teasing themselves out. Another problem is sort of classic measurement problems. If they're sensors, you have to understand at what level of precision and accuracy you're looking for your data. If you're thinking about location, or you're thinking about time, very different requirements for different sorts of business or other sorts of situations. If you're using the data for real-time computing, you might have extremely precise, highly accurate data. For other purposes, you might be taking a dump every day or two. So the demands and the needs that you might see downstream are also a problem. And typically, when you're designing the measurement system, you'd want to think about those sort of features and what the ends-to-ends are, eliminating measurement errors that might be methodological. So there's a lot of stuff that you can learn from those sorts of environments. But definitely spatiality and time are big issues. In any system right now, you're going to see issues around time and space. And those tend to introduce a lot of interesting topics about privacy. Other things that might be engineering side, we don't think of temperature and environment as all that big of a deal. But photovoltaics that are thin cell technologies tend to perform much better at higher temperatures and produce lower efficiencies at lower temperatures. They also have different fail rates. So depending on the path and the recorded history of its environment, you'd have a much better view of whether or not the reliability of a given system might perform at some mark level or not. So those are the sorts of things people might be thinking through that are definitely sort of, you can find corollaries in other sorts of markets. Manufacturing sector, transportation, almost anything. But you're not going to be able to deploy a system large scale that involves consumers without at least some recognition that information that directly could potentially identify someone or directly, and then some view of an analysis of that problem is a requirement. Because if you're talking about trying to elicit people's essentially participation in a model, they're going to have to feel comfortable with that at some level. And that balances against that ease of use and sort of business scenario. And if we look to Japan, there's a long history. If we think about, for example, iMode was around in 1999. And at that time, we were arguing about whether or not text messaging in the US would be big or not. Sleeka, which is, and I'll talk a little bit about that briefly here in a second, was a standard for, if you're out in the DC area, we have a smart trip. Out here, you'll have your BART cards and stuff. But it's a transportation wallet and sort of payment system. Been around for a very long time. And consumers, they engaged with these systems. And unlike you see with some sorts of technologies, you do see a lot of really interesting cutting-edge stuff in Asia many, many years before sometimes we see it in the US. So we might be looking to, in addition to the other IoT stuff we mentioned, how they're doing robotics and AI and how that's interacting with an aging society. You know, how people are going to interact with energy is fundamental to everything else. So internet and telecom, medical devices, many of the top players in each of these fields, in any of the fields that are leading IoT sort of sectors, is going to have a strong Asian presence. So there's definitely a lot to be looking to, both the technology side as well as from consumer behavior we talked about. So briefly, Japan, I think, is a really interesting jurisdiction for a lot of reasons. The first being they start from a sort of converged model of starting from a continental model and then transitioning through a number of years of influence from US law in particular. And today, if we wanted to think about privacy as a big piece of this, there have been interesting changes even in their privacy law in response to things like Suica. Suica had, you know, a very long history we discussed. And of course, as these systems naturally evolve, there have been exchanges of information between JR, the rail line that manages the system nationally, and other entities. And in the case of a particular exchange between...
You know, just to check, how many people in the room know what a Suica is? Okay, so for those of you who haven't been to Japan, it's a card that you tap and it is prepaid. It's kind of like a Clipper card here. Right, you tap it, it's prepaid, it gets you into the train system. You tap it again at the exit, and it automatically deducts the right amount of fare from the card. And so they're collecting tons, literally terabytes of information on this stuff.
And in the case of the exchange between Suica and Hitachi, among the things that were not exchanged were the Suica information about the user's name, and the number, as well as their purchase history and such. But simple things like their birth date, what stations they got on and off of, fees, and another quasi-identifier, another hashed sort of identifier, were all available. It caused huge problems, and it resulted in a change, essentially, to the national law. So if we're looking to how crowdsourcing and privacy can interact in these environments, they need to be adaptive, they need to be flexible, and they have to be focused on the data piece to some degree. It has to be understanding of what the consumer's sort of role is in this and some recognition of how to protect their privacy in that process. And again, to Richard's point earlier was really, really, really sharp. It also has to answer the sorts of questions that the system requires. So it might be statistical, might be traditional sort of like survey-based things, could be all sorts of data analysis, but that mean performance versus some other feature is probably going to end up being some part of the data science piece of these things. And I think, you know, the other question that's really interesting, at least for me, is when we enter these new environments, what is valid, what was sort of the key before, isn't always going to be the same. And so those are things I think we can look to for the future. Do we still have a few minutes? Or?
Yeah, keep going.
So I'm going to pass through this, but a little bit more about Japan as sort of a target jurisdiction. I'm more of a comparative legal scholar, a Japan guy, internet and spectrum stuff. But if you think about how we study comparative problems, if you're in the legal side, you're always going to the EU. Almost, you know, if you're going to study a comparative law textbook, the first three quarters of it's going to be about EU, some sort of continental history, and then there'll probably be like one chapter on what used to be called Oriental law. And so Japan has never been a strong focus for understanding legal systems, and it's also not been a real focus for even engineering or business or other sorts of features, despite the fact that it had been the second largest economy in the world for years and years, that it had been a key player in a lot of innovations that were part of US miracles happening. So when we're thinking about the convergence of communications and electricity, and that's really what we're talking about, and how those systems have a human-to-machine interface as well as a machine-to-machine interface, it would be, I think, a real tragedy not to understand what the trajectory has been in Asia and particularly in Japan. So briefly looking through what Japan has been doing, they were ahead of the curve again. So, I mean, here's the big surprise. Way back when, before nobody was looking at this, Japan had already been like doing this and had really amazing pilots, had reached production goals for targeted systems. There's a long history, especially with photovoltaics in Japan. They also remain relevant. So if you're looking at the gross production in Japan, versus other countries, as well as the amount of production for different sectors, Japan and the U.S. are still up there really high. Germany also is of course in the play, but interesting things like law and policy problems influence the trajectory in Germany. So if we were going to look at, you know, Richard had mentioned, you know, that the typical model is you plug these things in, the electricity passes through a box, it meters it. And at that point, at the billing stage, the electricity sort of in and out is measured and calculated, and then you get a bill or a check back. If you are buying the electricity at one rate and you're selling it at another rate, that might be something you'd want to know about as a consumer. If I'm investing in the system and the amount of electricity that I'm selling you is a little or a lot, you might want to think about what the cost recovery is from just sort of a naive perspective. So Germany, for example, has a little bit less favorable conditions around consumer use. Maybe if you look at how metering and things like that work, the thing to look to in Japan, if you're going to do any further research on this, is the Saisei Kano Energi no Kotei Kakaku Baishu Seido. So there was recently essentially a fixed price associated with what you can realize as a consumer. It's part of marketing materials and otherwise well understood. So if we're thinking about different models, at least having the things that are obvious in place seems to be a good place to start.
Yeah, just before you leave that, this is all about the amount of photovoltaic production in Japan, right?
Yes.
So the right-hand graph is, you know, the bottom line is domestic production, the line above that was for export, and the total production is the top line of solar cells produced. The left-hand side has to do with the system value per kilowatt hour in terms of tens of thousands of yen. That's the bar graph, which goes down, right? It gets cheaper per kilowatt hour. The squares, the line of squares,
the
is
blue line. Yeah.
Solar cell production for residential use and at also in tens of thousands of kilowatt hours. And the triangles is total adoption, right, of solar, of PV production.
That's right. And I think PV tends to be a place to start because that's easy to deploy. Wind tends to be much more difficult in sort of a residential context. Now, again, this is separate from big farms, so large-scale solar farms and other sorts of cases are different. But METI, at least, has also done a lot of analysis around the stuff that they've done in the past. They do have interesting sort of takeaways. There are a couple, these are four case studies that they have looked at. I think the one at the bottom right is probably the more interesting one, or actually the bottom left, where you've got a neighborhood where everyone is a producer and everyone is a consumer of electricity, and all of it is more or less off the grid and contained. That's pretty exciting. The net in and out is, I think the total is this is 2,129 kilowatts, or two megawatts of power per.
And it was its own self-contained grid.
Yeah, so this is the first solar city.
Okay.
There are a couple other cases. Here's a resiliency case, and again, incorporating things like intelligent PVs in the design of the building, putting PVs on windows. So there's a lot of potential that we see realized already as the intersection of urban design and construction and things are going around in Japan. So there's a lot to look there, and I think if we want to think about things like iMode or Sleeka, and if we were sitting back in 1999 or earlier and looking at some of these great IoT sorts of breakthroughs, we'd look at graphs. And if we're going to look at renewable energies for Japan today, they realize about 3.2% of renewables from non-water sources. So these are wind, solar, or others. That pie graph is pretty exciting. In maybe 20 years from now, they'll have a different pie graph, and maybe we'll put U.S. by this, but I hope we'll accelerate a little bit better than that. Shall we close then? And let me open it up for discussion. I'm really excited to hear people's thoughts. And I know there was a question over here early. Yeah?
Just one observation. You're talking about having to put sensors and communications to be able to measure energy. You can actually, each electrical device in the home actually puts off a signature. And so you can actually monitor that from smart meters or sensors that are able to do that. So you don't necessarily need to have each device having a communications path to get that information.
Yeah, and it's exciting. You see some of those sorts of features incorporated in like BPL solutions. So there has been a history of using the AC grid to carry information. And in the past, the broadband over power line was what was sort of adopted in the regulatory space. But go ahead. Right.
At the meter, it can actually tell from the actual signature
right.
On that's going through the electrical line.
So I think if we wanted to sort of expand on that, for example, and I knew that my laptop is at 20% charge. It needs some voltage at some, say 30 watt to charge in 20 minutes. An exchange of information explicitly between that and the grid might open up the opportunity, for example, to walk into a restaurant and maybe they get presented via some sort of an information channel on the laptop. We're going to give you a free charge at, whatever, 400 milliwatts or whatever for your smartphone, and it'll take, an hour to charge it or whatever. Or if you want the fast charge option, we offer that for $2 or something. Those sorts of things you might see in a coffee shop, for example, but we haven't realized those sorts of things in the electricity space. And you're right, there are absolutely features of devices that we can see already. Those could have been taken advantage of. There could have been solutions. I'm not aware of anyone that does essentially fingerprinting of the RF. Well, there are some sectors that do that, but that's a separate discussion. I don't know if anybody uses that on the smart meter side.
Fraunhofer actually developed some of the techniques for being able to actually detect the signature of that. So, and I know there is a company out of Canada that has a startup company that has a device, and you put it on the smart meter and claim they were able to detect that information.
So the police already can tell if you're using a lot of power. My friend has a glass blowing apparatus in his garage, and
got a
blast furnace. The police come by at least once every 3 or 4 months to see if he's growing marijuana.
Tuesday. Yes, please.
Okay, so a question on the regulation side. I understand in the state of California, and from my readings in local newspapers, et cetera, local utility is PG&E. It's a monopoly. It's a regulated monopoly, right? So electricity is sold to consumers at a specific rate. It's variable by time of day, et cetera. But other than that, as far as I know, this is what you pay. Now, if I set up solar and I sell to PG&E, right now, as I understand it, I get that retail rate for the energy that I sell back. But PG&E wants to pay me the wholesale rate. That's what they think is fine. So that's the first question. What do you think is fair from a regulatory point of view? And the other one is, if you have a monopoly in a large, massive distributed model in a city, then you go to individuals that are generating this and they want to sell it. They can sell at any price that they want, presumably. So what's fair in terms of regulating that?
Well, I think, first of all, my personal opinions, sadly, I wasn't running this year, but when I am king, I think a good model, at least from my perspective, is to enable a lot of different kinds of exchanges and to make sure that the system is flexible and can accommodate a lot of different kinds of business agreements. I think what we're talking about, you're suggesting maybe there are models that, maybe the consumer doesn't have the kind of bargaining rights or hasn't achieved the sorts of agreements that they want. In a system that doesn't prohibit different agreements, they could influence, the market could evolve, and you could see a change to that. You could see another provider, for example, step in and do that. So if there's a problem around, for example, an individual or a pool of individuals getting together and developing an alternative, or someone just going off the grid altogether, and that would be violative of something, I could see that as a problem. You don't want to force people to buy power. And in some cases in the U.S., there have been incidents where someone had issues at the municipal level around being off the grid and that being an issue. And there's corollaries also in things like water rights. So it seems peculiar, probably to many, that you might be in a jurisdiction and put a bucket to collect rainwater under your house and then get fined. But in fact, aquarium rights have a very long history as well. And so I think if you were looking at it and trying to construct systems that were flexible and could take advantage of the sorts of production and consumption benefits we could have, you'd want a system that's flexible. And it should be able to accommodate users both being producers as well as consumers. Now, how you do that, and then how you essentially have a market that's flexible like that, it's not a trivial problem. But I would suggest you could look to communications for interesting corollaries to that.
James, I want to cut to the chase. Do you think, because we do have different regulation frameworks in Japan and the United States, do you think that's going to affect the direction of the power grid for the next 15 or 20 years? Do you think that the Japanese are going to involve less renewables? Are they going to maintain more of a sort of centralized network as opposed to here?
Yeah. Well, what do we want to do? We put our economist hats on, I suppose, as much as our lawyer hats, and wonder, for example, how incentives, you know, affect an economy and consumers' adoptions and things. But if we want to look to other examples, the case that you brought up, if you buy a system, let's say it costs $10,000, and if you produce more power and you can sell it back at a rate that's higher, you're more likely to invest in that because, you know, there's some surety around being able to recover something on the investment in that residual. If it's a case where then maybe you could spec it up or spec it down, depending on, you know, that decision, you might also be influenced on what the rate you're going to get at. So I think absolutely things around billing and how you interact with the existing utility grid probably have some influence on the U.S.-Japan comparative. And of note, if you are going to do the purchase exchange model in Japan, I think it does restrict you to a system. You may not buy a system and be part of that program if the capacity of the system exceeds your yearly typical consumption. So, for example, if I am consuming, you know, X, you know, kilowatt hours per year, and I get a system that's 2X of that, clearly I'm looking to sell power back to the grid. And currently, I think that would be something that would be disincentivized in Japan. I think, you know, then you would see, well, maybe somebody in the neighborhood wants to do that. Maybe they don't mind cluttering their roof with all that stuff. There's risks of leaks. There's all sorts of other stuff. People maybe trade off. Maybe some people are more averse to that investment and some people are more aggressive. You could imagine a model which didn't have that prohibition, and you might see a neighborhood where some people might buy bigger cells and some people might buy smaller or none, and there might be an exchange that's transacted locally. So folks that have worked in this sector more or less over the last 5 or 10 years, there are folks over at Lawrence Berkeley Labs, for example. There's a guy, Bruce Nordman, who has some interesting papers if you're interested in reading those. And he talks about how you might have an economic model around those sorts of problems in a neighborhood where people might be buying different sort of kinds of solar solutions and essentially transacting among themselves. If it's the case that we talked about that DC line loss, right, and there is a hard limit on how far you'd want to carry DC, if you're in a densely sort of populated neighborhood where there's a lot of townhomes, maybe that concern from a physics perspective would be less of an issue. Maybe those sorts of solutions might be architected and implemented more easily. So I think there's also a mix of what the technology solution would provide also, because there's definitely going to be efficiencies for different kinds of a system. If you've got an AC inverter sort of a system, I think, you know, naturally it varies, but you might be losing 40%, 25%, 60% of the total amount of power in the system every time you invert it back and forth. So the losses associated with the production are sort of the leaky bucket problem. If you are carrying it between houses and the leak is pretty small and you're not carrying it very far, it might not be a problem. If your bucket has that same small leak, but you got to carry it twice the distance, you might end up with a loss that's bigger than the one you start with. So I think both of those will influence the technology piece, how those communities can form, and then, of course, what the regulation incentives are.
So I've got one other question that I really wanted to ask today, and that is, so we had this distributed denial of service attack on various internet websites, and the things that were the origins were things like DVR players and other kinds of, really, Internet of Things devices that normally don't communicate with people. It's all machine-to-machine communications. So if you add this kind of information into the power grid, are you going to have the regulators making sure that it's really secure? And how's that likely to play out differently in Japan than the U.S.?
Well, taking the Japan case and another sort of corollary from communications, Wi-Fi was always hard to find in Japan for years and years and years. People had a real phobia around Wi-Fi. There were concerns about the security of the connections and the privacy. Largely the concerns that were very, very, you know, legitimate early on were non-existent at some point, and it continued. Yeah. So some of this is perception. It's not just the consumer behavior of the consumers, but it's also the sort of impressions and behaviors of different actors in the system. And certainly different people have different, they have different perceptions of risk, and those certainly would influence, you know, how aggressive or how passive an actor might be when they're regulating. Certainly for, and this is really down to this veracity problem, you know, this is not a problem that's isolated to power. It's a problem with braking systems in automatic cars. It's a problem with, you know, remote access for any sort of home automation systems. It's industrial security. This is a problem that's broad, and I think people are looking at it in the IoT space very closely, and I think probably there will continue to be interest from the regulated sectors and certainly the regulators themselves.
Maybe one more question? If not, thanks to the Minor Foundation, we have some refreshments outside. We'd like to stay around and talk with each other, meet each other, and also talk more with James informally. James, thank you very much.